The couple I'm about to meet are nomads. They've been travelling for the past 20 years, but now they've decided to settle here in the Campsie Fells in Scotland. And the house they're going to build? Well, that is going to be built from a palette of materials from all over the world. The only thing that they are buying from their local builders' merchants are a few of these. The Campsie Fells in Stirlingshire, just north of Glasgow, are surrounded by villages offering a real flavour of rural Scotland. Living near Loch Lomond, it's easier to see why Teo and Elaine Lyser have chosen this part of the world to bring up their two sons, Timo and Rowan. Teo's originally from Holland. He and Elaine met whilst living in Africa, working for aid organisations there. After years of travelling, they finally decided to settle down in Elaine's native Scotland.
We've travelled around quite a bit over the years, and we feel it's quite good for the family to build a home, really, to find a place where we can settle.
By building this house, we're going to get a house that's tailored to our needs as a family, within an environment we really like. It's a lovely piece of land with a lovely view, and it's just too tempting. We had to really give it a go.
So how did you find this this site?
Browsing through a magazine.
You're joking.
Yeah.
Seriously?
Yeah.
And nobody ever finds a plot in a magazine. Were you even looking to build?
We had talked about doing something in the future, but we weren't actively seeking a building plot.
So why then? I mean, why are you going to build here?
Well, look at the views. Look at that.
That is amazing.
It keeps changing.
But why build at all? Why don't you just buy a house?
I mean, we've lived in an awful lot of places, awful lot of different houses, and there's always been something wrong with each one of them. There's always something that you would prefer to change. And it's just lovely to have the opportunity to try and get it right yourself.
I also think it's trying to create your own home, because you feel much more involved, and you can actually create something which is really yours. This is ours. This is going to be our place in this setting. Oh, yeah. Views over there, the hills, woods over there. It's going to be fantastic.
So what's it going to look like, this place?
Well, quite contemporary, actually, which is quite different from the surrounding buildings.
Mm. I think the house will blend into the woods, at ease with this environment.
This is going to be an environmentally friendly house, built in two halves. A two-storey timber frame clad in a rough coat of cedar shingles, or shakes, will sit on a concrete basement built into the hill, where French doors will lead to a guest bedroom and a soundproof games room for the boys. A central staircase will take you right up into the heart of the house. This isn't a large building, but a spectacular double-height living room will make it feel much bigger than it is. Deep-framed windows will control the views out, although the best view will be from the sheltered terrace by the kitchen, an outdoor space inspired by Teo and Elaine's travels. As you move through it, the building will seem to contract and expand. A narrow staircase will lead to a generous landing that itself serves the two compact boys' bedrooms, the bathroom, and Teo and Elaine's master bedroom and ensuite. And, tucked away, a tiny home office set on a gallery, which overlooks the living space below. Teo and Elaine want a sustainable and modest home that sits happily in its setting. And they think they can get a better quality house by importing building materials from around the world.
The nice thing is that a lot of the materials come from all over the place. Like the floors, for instance, they are coming from America. The shakes are coming from Canada. The windows are coming from Sweden. It's a mixture of international materials brought together in one beautiful house.
Elaine, are you as passionate about this? I mean, who's leading who here?
It's something we very much wanted to do together, and it's something we've followed through the planning process together and together with the architect. The whole point behind it is finding somewhere where we want to stay, where we want to settle down a wee bit and, you know, put an end to the sort of nomadic lifestyle that we've had.
So how much then is the whole thing going to cost?
Maximum of £350,000.
Including the site?
Including the whole site.
Right, that's not bad. But what happens if you need another £50,000 to finish?
And I think we'll either have to find different employment or put the project on hold and maybe finish it later.
Really?
Or sell.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, so it's that severe a situation?
I think yes. I think we're stretching ourselves really to our maximum, what is feasible. But this is something we really want to do.
I think this is a really exciting project. It's contemporary, it's sustainable, and perhaps most importantly of all, it's exactly what Theo and Elaine want. They know their own minds. But it's also a tad complicated. They're sourcing all the materials from four separate countries, five if you include England, which strikes me as a bit fussy. And given that Theo's never done anything like this before, a little bit frightening.
But Theo comes from Holland, a country where almost everyone builds their own home. He's not daunted, and he's spent 3 years researching super-performing eco-products. It's been up to architect Christopher Platt to implement all of his ideas.
First thing that strikes me about this model is that I didn't know a cube could be so interesting. It seems to have a lot of exciting spaces and a lot of, you know, they're going to enjoy living here.
Hopefully.
And yet, it isn't going to cost an absolute fortune. How can you do that for that budget?
Well, the choice of the structure is important and the choice of the form. The overall design is a fairly compact cube. It's fairly efficient. I mean, it's timber frame. It's clad in timber. It's sitting on a fairly straightforward masonry rendered base. So I think it's just a well-conceived and well-thought-out building.
Theo is also getting very involved himself, sourcing materials from other countries. How problematic is that?
I think it depends on the coordination of the main contractor, how early they place these orders and just the how they go about their business. So there's always a risk because you're making buildings out of bits and those materials come from all over the place. There's always a risk of delays.
Theo and Elaine have given themselves just 6 months to build their house. But this is a tricky site. Hillsides usually are. In the end, builder Peter Newton was willing to take on a job that 17 other contractors had already turned down.
It's been really quite difficult finding a builder. It's not an easy site. It's quite a steep hill and it involves a lot of digging out.
Peter will build the concrete basement, but not the whole house. This is because Theo has hired a different company to build the upper two floors, the timber frame. Having two main contractors on site is an unusual arrangement.
For centuries, people have been putting up buildings and organising their labour in a vertical chain of command with a sort of military hierarchy. And it works. But Theo, in his wisdom, has decided instead to split his chain of command and instead employ two main contractors. Peter, who's going to do all the groundworks and the concreting, and the timber frame company, who are going to build the house on top. And somehow, these two firms have got to sort of rub along together. They've got to share responsibility. They've got to divvy up the blame when things go wrong. They've got to communicate. The question is whether their relationship really is going to be like this or like this.
Weeks ago, Theo and Elaine Lizer began building a sustainable timber-framed house in rural Scotland. So far, the builders have removed hundreds of tons of earth and filled the hole with concrete. It's not very eco-friendly, but it will create a basement on which the timber frame will sit.
They've only started a few weeks ago, but everything's just going as planned.
It's right bang to schedule. This day was going to be pouring, this day was going to be digging, and everything has worked out excellent. So excellent planning and organisation. So no, very pleased.
So far, things are going well. But Teo and Elaine have decided to organise the work in a very unusual way, asking one contractor, Peter Newton, to build the basement and another to build the timber frame on top. It can be tricky having two main contractors because it's not clear who's in charge. And it's made even more complicated because Teo is importing most of his materials from overseas.
You've been making a lot of decisions about this building, haven't you? I mean, you decided that you wanted a timber frame house for a start.
I think we moved towards timber frames because of, I think, an experience we've had in Sweden. Having spent some time in Sweden through work, those houses felt very solid, felt comfortable. So we started to look at some of the materials that are being used in these frames and how they construct the houses.
Well, that's exciting. But you also say you want this house to be sustainable. So how can you justify bringing all this stuff in by freight, you know, from all corners of the globe on the one hand, and on the other, building sustainably?
I think you're right, but if you were to look, say, for 1 or 2 years, of course, it would be very expensive in terms of energy use, in terms of emissions that you produce. But let's take it over the 50, 100 years. I suspect that by creating a lot more friendly, more efficient house, we would quite easily save the transport cost.
Teo wants to build a super warm, super efficient timber-framed house. And they're not that easy to find in Britain. Thankfully, he has found a company who will import the frame from Sweden and assemble it to the architect's spec. But they're not in Scotland. They're 450 miles away, in Devon.
There is a common perception that prefabricated housing is about as imaginative as a British Rail sandwich. Bland, made in some anonymous factory somewhere, and is about as substantial as cardboard. But mercifully, things have improved.
There are out there 1 or 2 timber kits that are pieces of high technology engineering. Teo searched all over Europe to find an environmentally friendly build method. This Swedish system is incredibly thermally efficient and at £70,000, reasonably cheap and really quite smart.
Apart from this dense Scandinavian timber carcass, the sheet materials used to make a panel like this start on the outside with this stuff. Now, this cladding board is very clever because not only is it waterproof, it's also breathable. And that's followed by the insulation of your choice, and then a vapor barrier just to keep the drafts out. And finally, this stuff. This internal cladding is a bit like plasterboard, except it's made from gypsum reinforced with recycled newspaper. Now, it's very, very tough. And that too is water resistant. Now, this means that the entire structure, when it gets to Scotland, can very happily just sit out in the rain for several months. And this sandwich has a shelf life of several hundred years.
Following the architect's detailed plans, everything from the window openings to the plug sockets are built into the frame whilst it's in the factory. The only jobs left once it's assembled on site will be to add the roof, the windows, and the cedar cladding. This is one giant piece of flat-packed furniture. Back on site, the rather more primitive groundworks are taking a little longer to make. After weeks, Peter is just finishing. Meanwhile, Teo and Elaine are still hoping to move in August, just 4 months from now.
It's really nice to see the footprint of the house because you can really now start to imagine where rooms are going to be, how it's going to look. It makes me feel great.
Peter now has to stand back until the end of the job and hand over responsibility for the site and the schedule to the timber frame contractors.
So, this is all your own work, Peter, isn't it, this, eh?
Yeah, mine and quite a few others besides. It's been the result of quite a few weeks' work.
And you being a builder, do you feel a bit sore about just actually providing the plinth for this house and not being able to build the rest of it in masonry as well?
No, I think the timber kit idea, I know it's probably quite widely used in Scotland and possibly not much in England. There are those that would say that traditional build is the only way to go, but I think timber kit is it's certainly got its place.
So you're happy to do the humble groundworks?
Well, the humble groundworks are not that humble with this one.
If all goes well, Peter will be back in a few weeks' time to oversee the first and second fix. Meantime, Teo and Elaine can fine-tune the specification for the building. The success of this design rests on it blending into its setting, so the choice of exterior timber cladding is going to be crucial. This is British Columbia in Canada. The cedar shakes Teo and Elaine want to use on the outside of the timber frame will come from these sustainably managed forests. They're keen to check the origin of their materials and find out how they look. So before making a final decision, they've travelled here to see exactly how the timber's produced.
So this tree could actually end up on our house in Scotland eventually.
Pieces of this tree could go to three or four different sawmills and end up all around the world.
Cedar is grown on a large scale in its native Canada, and it's one of the best woods for protecting a building from the weather. It's also environmentally friendly. The shakes themselves are salvaged from old, twisted scraps of cedar tree that can't be used for anything else.
One of the things we're trying to looking at is what to put on the wall as cladding for the house. We're not entirely sure yet what kind, what type, what grade we need to put on.
Well, with the premium shake like this, you get great water repellency from it because of the tightness of the grain. The oil content of the cedar is also very helpful in water repellent.
So you don't need to do anything with it, is that right? You
no.
just put it on and that's it?
Even, it can be applied naturally like this without any treatment.
We've done a lot of research looking at exactly what we want, trying to find really the best materials for our requirements or for our house that we can afford. And I think by bringing it in ourselves, hopefully we can get high quality and save quite a bit of money and build on a fairly tight budget, still a very nice and good quality house.
At the end of May, they return to site to be greeted by an enormous scaffold. Today's the day their timber frame arrives. Now then.
Oh, Elaine, look at that.
Look at that.
Oh, gosh. Goodness.
Look at that.
Oh, wow, that's enormous.
It's got to be a municipal building.
For now, Peter's taken a back seat because the timber frame contractors have arrived on site with a promise to completely construct the top two floors of this building in just 2 weeks.
There you are. There's your house.
It's coming. But you wouldn't think that was actually a ground floor, would you? It actually looks
that's
like
that's the whole of the ground floor.
That's the whole of the ground floor.
Teo and Elaine's August deadline is now only 3 months away. Luckily, each panel arrives prefabricated, complete with insulation, internal walls, even sockets. They're simply lifted off a lorry and dropped into position.
There you go.
It is your front
That's
door.
That's my front door.
Of course, what you have now is you have not just a wall up, you have a corner of the house.
A corner of the house. Is that
I love the fact you've got little light switches and sockets already kind of in there, you know, waiting to be used almost, you know, waiting to be wired up.
It's exactly what everything's going to be.
There's this, an immediate sense of solidity, and yet, of course, they are just like big pieces of stage scenery, aren't they? These it's timber frames.
I counted how many nails we're putting in. It was about 4 or 5 nails holding up these.
Remarkably simple, isn't it?
Simple, strong walls. So.
But is it? I mean, is it really solid when you hit it?
I think it is. I think it feels like
it's good, isn't it?
A real wall. A brick, solid wall.
All progress on the build is now in the hands of the second contractor, the timber frame company. And the man in charge of keeping to the tight schedule is Neil Bricknell.
So how kind of close then is your culture to on-site builders technology and culture?
It's always a sunny day in the factory. Whereas on site, they've got the weather to contend with, they've got various other difficulties that just spring up upon them.
Yeah.
And the secret is to try and bring the two halves of the same apple together.
Yeah, well, that's in theory, because, I mean, on the one hand, you've got the site guy, in this case, Peter, who's building his concrete plinth to drawings. You're producing your frame to drawings from the same architect.
Yep.
How often does it not quite fit?
9 times out of 10, everything goes well. The odd 10% we try and keep quiet about.
And now you're on site. Who's boss?
Well, Peter's boss of his bit. This is our bit.
For Teo's sake, I just hope this project isn't that nasty 1 in 10. His budget and his schedule are under pressure, and each delivery of panels to site is a welcome one.
We're still hoping to get the project finished on August the 22nd. And of course, in addition, the finances are running quite tight. So the earlier we move in and stop paying the rent and stop having large bills for this build, the better it is for us. I don't want to end up in a situation whereby we say, well, sorry, we've run out of money and we have to sell this house. We really want to live here, so we don't want to move out. So 22nd is quite firm on our radar at the moment. And I really hope we'll finish by that time.
The next week is filled with excitement and promise. Most of the panels have been fixed into place and the top two floors are almost complete. But the windows for the building haven't yet arrived on site. They should have been supplied by the timber frame contractor. But somewhere along the line, the Scottish architect and the timber frame company based in England have got their wires crossed.
There is a very sensible Scottish building regulation which says that any window in a new house like this one over a certain height has to be easily cleanable from the inside. So Scottish windows perform tricks like this. Look at that, that is beautiful. This thing reverses on itself. Trouble is that in ordering Teo and Elaine's windows, that regulation, that essential piece of information sort of went astray, which means that they now have to reorder all of their windows, and that could take months.
Time that Teo and Elaine just can't afford. But this cock-up doesn't surprise me. There are two main contractors here from opposite ends of the country working to different regulations.
It's always simpler if there is one main contractor and subcontractors are, as it were, answerable to that main contractor. When there's a separately appointed subcontractor by the client, it does complicate it a little bit, and that stops the clear loop of communication from just keeping, you know, going round and round.
It's bad enough having to reorder the windows, but the error is made worse by the fact they're coming from Sweden. The Swedish factory closes down for the whole of July in just 3 weeks, leaving little time to get the windows made and shipped to Scotland. Amazingly, Teo and Elaine are still positive about when they'll actually move in.
I think we are going to be in on August the 22nd.
We will be in on August the 22nd. Doesn't look much at the moment. The order is in and it looks like the windows are going to be here on time. A lot of faith in the Swedes. They will work hard. They'll get the windows done before they close down in July, and the windows will be in on time and we'll move in on time.
Unfortunately, I can't share Teo and Elaine's optimism. I can't make the sums add up. There's Peter saying the windows are going to be 6 weeks. Meanwhile, Neil says they're going to be 8 weeks from Sweden, and that takes us to the end of July, 3 weeks before Teo and Elaine need to move in. And they can't do so many things to this place until the windows are there. I just don't know how they're going to plaster, render, paint, finish this whole place in 3 weeks. It's now the middle of June, 4 months into this build, and time is running out for Teo and Elaine Liza. They were hoping to be in their new home by August. But although the timber frame is up and the roof structure's almost complete, there's no sign of the windows.
How are you managing to keep the water out of the building? Because it's raining.
Yeah, at the moment we're not able.
So it just comes in and sits there and pools and the timber gets wet. Tell me about the windows, because I'm hoping that they're going to arrive in time.
We still have not been given the confirmed delivery date.
Marvellous. Do you know where the job is in the factory?
I haven't got a clue. I haven't got a clue.
But Teo thinks he's still going to be able to get in, doesn't he, on the 22nd of August?
to say that Teo and Elaine might be in by the 22nd of August, I think, is possibly unlikely at best.
I think it's possibly impossible. Right.
The complicated setup on this build is starting to unravel. The two contractors have been scheduled to follow on from each other, but the timber frame company can't finish until the windows arrive, and it's starting to affect everything Peter has left to do. It's made even more difficult by the fact that the windows are coming all the way from Sweden. It's not just a simple matter of visiting a local supplier to see what the holdup is. At least Peter can get on with the roof. It's made from a lightweight rubberized material and offers some relief from the relentless Scottish weather. It's the only part of the building that can actually be finished.
So what are these guys doing?
They're boring up the windows.
Because
the real windows are not quite out of the factory yet.
No, Teo.
It's a real pity.
You were hoping for delivery in June, but there's no way then.
I don't think it's going to be possible.
Which means it's going to be delivered in August.
It'll be delivered early August. And then they can be in.
You want to be in by the 22nd?
We will be.
You cannot be in by the 22nd. I mean, I appreciate they're going to board this up, which means that they can at least work in the dry.
We're still very positive and hopeful
that you'll be in by the 22nd.
I will be in. We will be moving on the
22nd. I mean, I did think that you would be. I mean, the only thing that has held you up are the windows.
Are the windows, yeah.
This delay is really unfortunate, and it adds to Teo and Elaine's rental and mortgage costs. There's a danger they may even have to sell the house. To make matters worse, the Swedish window supplier shuts down for the whole of July, so it could be the middle of August before the windows arrive. The only option is for Peter to carry on working inside, but of course, it'll be in completely the wrong order.
So what kind of problems does that throw up for you?
The problems we have really are how we can finish certain aspects of the job. It is actually quite tight, the programme. We were hoping to do the plastering.
But presumably there's only so much work you can do on
exactly.
site before you kind of hit a point where...
We've got to put our hands up and say, you know, let's just
no more.
Get on with it. Yeah.
You get the roof on, you do the groundworks, you landscape the site,
mm-hmm.
and then it's like...
We could polish the... No, we haven't got the windows. So
you can't polish the windows?
We can't polish the windows either, so...
The build limps along as the underfloor heating and screeding go down. Peter's putting pressure on the timber frame contractor to try and speed up the arrival of the windows from Sweden. But he has no control over them because he's not in charge. All they can do is wait.
It's been a wee bit worrying.
It's been a bit frustrating as well, to be honest, because we were really psyched up to move in the end of August. So we need to get a firm date and we need to get the windows in and move in as quick as we can. Because of course, the time delay is always costing money. We're paying rent in accommodation where we stay at the moment. Of course, we're paying more or less a full mortgage for the new house at the moment. So we need to reduce our outgoings, whatever happens, as quick as we can.
Yeah.
Thankfully, not all of the materials Teo and Elaine chose from overseas suppliers failed to materialize. The Canadian cedar shakes do arrive on time. They will transform the exterior of this building. That is, once all 7,000 of them have been carefully nailed in place.
They weigh a ton. I see why you asked us to bring these up for you. My goodness.
There you go.
How long will it take you to get through that lot?
About 18 minutes.
18 minutes.
Oh, well, that's accurate, isn't it?
Oh, well, we're leaving in 17. What a shame. It looks rather nice, doesn't it?
It looks very special. Not a single one is the same, isn't it?
It looks like a sort of giant pine cone, you know, kind of overlayering bits of wood, very textured.
Must be quite a job to put them on.
How much do these things cost? Do you know?
Altogether, the whole house, which needs about 180 square metres, would be £2,500 to £3,000.
Well, that's okay. Plus the installation as well.
Plus the insulation, plus the nails. The nails are very expensive. You just need a wood, and apparently you can't use galvanized nails because then they start to rust.
It's
not cheap.
No, but it is beautiful.
You know, banging £250 worth of nails in this wall.
Yeah, but you're commissioning something beautiful. You know, it's going to look something else, isn't it? It's going to look really lovely when it's done.
It's very special.
The natural oil in the cedar wood will preserve and waterproof this tough new outer skin, completing a wall structure that'll be thermally efficient. Good news for Teo and Elaine, who want a house that's cheap to heat and run. The bad news, however, is that every month that goes by costs them money they simply don't have. They really do need to make savings.
Yeah, I think there's still quite a bit of work to do in the house. But we're going to have to probably do a lot of the finishing ourselves. Yeah. So we and might maybe have a bit more than we initially anticipated doing ourselves.
To compensate for the delay caused by the windows, Teo and Elaine adopt the risky strategy of having the first and second fix done. And to try and recoup some of the extra costs, they're doing any work they can themselves.
Feels like I'm building it brick by brick at the moment, just because it's going on for so long, I think. We thought we had planned it so that, you know, that would be the situation for 6 months, and at the moment it's been the situation for almost 9 months. I think if you didn't feel there was an end in sight, it might be pretty awful and put a lot of stresses and strains on a marriage, but no, there's an end in sight, so I don't think it's a problem, but it's certainly been different.
By mid-September, the cedar shakes are on and the scaffolding has been taken down to reveal a promising building. Elaine, Teo and Peter the builder are giving this project 100%. But despite the Swedish factory having reopened 2 months ago, there's still no sign of the windows. And without them, everyone is powerless to get this place finished.
Hello?
Hello? Wow, look at this place. Look, plasterwork, painting, lights, second fix. I mean, what more could they possibly do without these bloody windows? Look, that's supposed to be glass. So's that, look, nothing. No sign of them. You know, doing all this work in fits and starts like this is completely arse about tit. I mean, this is not the way to build a house, is it? Hmm? It's going to cost them a fortune.
It aggravates me, and I'm not even working on the place. So how does Peter see it all panning out?
So, we still don't have any windows.
No. Where are they now?
In Sweden.
Still?
Yeah.
And who's going to put them in?
The timber frame supplier.
And who's going to offload them off the lorry?
The timber frame supplier.
So he's going to be here when the lorry arrives?
If he isn't, then we'll be turning the lorry away. We're not responsible for the windows.
So, no, I know. I mean, I did think that this was the most beautifully run job because you had this kind of, what I thought was a fairly clear division and fairly clear hierarchy. But in fact, it's like having two main contractors, isn't it? That's the weakness of this project, is that Teo's effectively appointed this company to do the frame and the windows, and you're having to dovetail in with them,
yeah.
Which is tricky.
Peter simply cannot push the build forward. He's relying on the timber frame company to chase the window manufacturer and then tell him what's going on. But he hasn't heard anything for weeks.
We're tearing our hair out probably just as much as Teo and Elena. It's extremely frustrating. We're really just doing very small amounts of work. It doesn't really warrant me being here all the time. And we can't get on. So we're going to go, come back when everything arrives. We want to be finished, we want to be away, and we want to give Teo and Elaine the keys to the door. But we can't do that.
By the end of the month, Peter has no option but to close the site down. And the building sits abandoned for weeks. But finally, 5 months later than scheduled, the windows arrive on site. The timber frame contractors have travelled back from Devon to fit them.
Absolutely fantastic to see these windows arrive, isn't it? I've been waiting for this such a long time. I think it's going to look absolute stunning. It's going to be fantastic.
Please don't drop it, whatever you do.
Wow.
These are super insulating triple glazed units. They're made from composite engineered timber, and most importantly, Teo is absolutely convinced they were the right choice.
I can't go. I want to see the windows go in and see how the house suddenly changes shape and form and feel.
I think it has been worth the wait, because I don't think you can get this quality of windows from here, locally sourced. It's a good example, I think.
In total, there are 20 units to install, and despite taking months to arrive from Sweden, they'll all be fitted in just one day.
1 hour, and we have 4 windows in already, and powering ahead is absolutely superb.
It's brilliant, and you really get a feel for, you know, how the room looks and how the light comes into it. It's just brilliant, because it's just been a big block of wood there for months now, so really pleased, a beautiful view.
Theo and Elaine have now decided on a new deadline, to completely move in before Christmas, 6 weeks from now.
The fact that we're still in rented accommodation and haven't been able to move out yet is really having a bad impact on our financial situation. So it's actually very, very tough in terms of living, and it's quite tough on the family. So I think it's an extra push, really, for us to move as soon as possible, really, to get out and move into our new home, whether it's ready or not.
Before they can move in, all of the internal joinery, the doors, the architraves and the skirting boards, need to be fitted. But, like the windows, they too have been supplied by the timber frame contractor.
Hello?
Hello?
Hi, Theo.
Hi, how are you?
Hello.
Hello there, how are you?
Very well. How are you?
Just grand,
thank
you.
Paint speckled, covered in sawdust.
Well, we certainly have been, yeah.
Checking out.
Got a kitchen going in.
Oh, I know, it's lovely, isn't it? Really pleased.
It's terrific, isn't it?
Yeah.
And goodness me, you know, the last time I was here, this place was so shut up, it felt, you almost needed a torch, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
yes,
yeah, it was like
but
that
now,
for a while.
Now, it's, now you've got the windows, and thank goodness for that.
It's wonderful,
good,
isn't it?
Now you actually appreciate how much light is coming into the
house. Yeah. So I guess the only thing you've got left to do is a bit of second fix and a bit of painting and all these architrave details and doors.
A few yeah. more internal doors.
Which have yet to come from where?
Guess where?
From Sweden.
Guess where our
doors come from. Via your timber frame company.
Yes, that's right.
What's the news?
Not entirely sure what's happening. I've had confirmation that the order is in, but I haven't had the confirmation.
Oh, that's good.
I haven't had confirmation yet when they're going to arrive on site.
Yeah. What a pain in the posterior this has been, hasn't it?
I think it's been a frustrating process. It has been quite stressful, especially the nearer we get to being there, but not quite. We've been a year in the rented house, which was initially budgeted for 6 months.
Okay, so you have to get out.
The house is soon going to be livable. You can see the kitchen's being finished off at the moment. The bathroom's being done upstairs.
Well, so when are you going to move in?
Beginning of December.
Probably start moving bits and pieces across end of November. But we will be out of our rented accommodation by the 6th of December.
Because you have to be.
We have to be.
Yeah.
It's a good job Theo and Elaine can't contain their excitement at moving in. A good job that they're just as excited by the idea of home. Because at this rate, they're going to have to move into theirs before it's finished. It's now January 2006, and Theo and Elaine and their two boys have moved in to an unfinished house. The internal joinery has only just arrived, which means they've spent weeks living in chaos.
When we first moved in December, we had the basics. We had our kitchen and one family bathroom, but we didn't have internal doors. We didn't have any wardrobe space. We didn't have any shelving.
There's still a few things we need to do before the whole thing is done, and I think we want to do it as quick as possible. I think there's a tendency, once you've moved in, to sit back and relax. So we're quite keen to really push on and really finish off.
Theo and Elaine intended to finish in August 2005. It's taken 5 months longer than they'd hoped. But now their house is complete, outside and in.
Hello.
Hi there.
I do like your house. I do like your house very much. I thought that this colour, the blue and the red, you know, wouldn't really work with the timber, but it looks absolutely brilliant. And you must be very satisfied now. It is done, finally.
Yeah, I love the wood. I love it on a day like today where you've got the sun hitting off it and it really lifts out the texture in the wood. And
I think the blue with the shakes go extremely well. But it's a very soft colour and actually blends in really quite nicely with the woods at the back.
Can we go inside?
Sure.
Of course.
I've always had a soft spot for this project. It's modest, sustainable, and it has a proper dialogue with the landscape around it, thanks to those cedar shakes and the way it sits into the hill. It's the meeting of sharp urban modernism and rustic charm.
Look, doors!
Wonderful, isn't it?
Wow!
Wonderful. There you go.
Gosh, what a nice space.
The feel is good. You walk in and you say, yes, it feels lovely.
Originally, I wondered how a cube could be so interesting. And here's the answer. Some major architectural ideas have been fitted into this space, as well as a series of private rooms.
What I particularly like is it isn't actually one single open plan space. It's a series of connected spaces. And things like this stairwell in the middle acts as a sort of divide, doesn't it? You've got a bit of a wall, you've got a table, you've got this sort of wraparound low wall here.
Yeah, I think it makes the building feel quite large when in actual fact it's not. I particularly like not being shut off, you know, in a kitchen when everything else is going on in the living room or whatever. I feel that we're much more together as the family.
You see, I can understand that working on a horizontal, that works very well to be able to connect between the kitchen and the dining room to talk to people and so on. But actually, what's really brave here is the way in which the building is also vertically connected. You know, you get this kind of this great big hole in the middle of the floor here, and here, this huge, huge void. I think this is the most exciting bit of the building, this great big double height space. It goes right to the roof.
And beyond.
And beyond.
And beyond.
Fabulous.
This just is so nice.
And it's blue light washing.
The light's actually coming through the curvy bit as well, so it actually disperses very nicely.
Although I have to say, actually, my favourite window in the whole building is this. This is like a giant picture.
It's a beautiful day today, but, you know, it's still winter, and at night it's obviously it's very dark out there. And so when we've had friends over in the evening or whatever, they've commented, why don't you have more in the way of artwork up in the walls? But that's the whole point, you know, this is the picture frame and that's the picture out there and it's lovely.
Now, this is art by God, isn't it?
The larger windows punch right through the walls with deep reveals and act as viewfinders, orientating your gaze out and sucking light in. Elsewhere, there's a more direct connection to the outside world.
That's great, isn't it? Really, really wonderful view.
Lovely.
And this corner of the building was always very important to you.
Yeah, we really wanted an area where we could come outdoors, feel the fresh air, but be protected.
I think it's similar to what we had in Malawi. We had a kind of a covered area and still brings the outside in and the inside out. Mm.
Well, this does the same thing, doesn't it? You've got this big overhang here to the canopy, which protects you from, I guess, the worst of the weather.
Mm. Absolutely.
But lets the sunshine in, certainly this time of year. Yeah. And with the kitchen just here, it allows you to just pull these doors open and bring a table out, sit, drink a cup of coffee, have a meal out here.
Absolutely.
This isn't a vast building, but it's so well designed it offers real value for money. Proper architecture on a budget. And don't forget, there's a basement with a soundproof games room and a guest suite. Whilst upstairs, the bedrooms are private, small, but perfectly formed, in contrast to the generous communal areas.
I like this space too. This is very generous for a landing. And this cheated space here. This is your study, yeah?
It's our little work hall.
Which is compact, but functional.
It actually works very well.
And you have, on the one hand, this sort of very enclosed, tight little space here with that little window.
It's brilliant because you sit working on your computer and you can just look out the window and see what's happening there.
So you can sit there, be totally occupied or turn around and kind of luxuriate in this kind of rather extravagant view of this big space.
This house is sustainable because it's so well constructed, so thermally efficient, and so minimally heated. These are all really thanks to Teo's persistence and passion. But in his pursuit of excellence, the schedule collapsed, and the project was only salvaged through their own hard work.
I think your Achilles heel was employing two contractors on an equal footing and expecting them somehow to get along with each other.
I think probably we were maybe not naive, but probably we're probably slightly ambitious.
Yeah. Tell me about this big principle of yours of bringing in these materials from abroad. Did in the end that work? The windows were a spectacular failure of that policy, weren't they?
Yes and no. They were spectacularly late, yeah. But we've got spectacularly nice windows. Our windows are really high quality, airtight, extremely good in keeping the heat inside the house. And I think, let's forget some of the struggles and some of the problems we've had, but let's look at the result, and we're very, very happy.
But you've also, haven't you, you've imported not just materials from around the world, but ideas as well.
Yes, I think that's fair to say. I think in this house we've been able to create the cosiness of other places that were cosy, and we've been able to get the feel for the outdoors, although we're in quite a different environment.
We've been able to create the separate bit for the family. We've been able to create a nice bit for socialising, getting friends in and having a meal together. It's those little things we've been able to bring in here.
I think we've got what we wanted from it.
This is the first house, I think, where we've lived, and you walk in here and say, yes, this is our home, this is us.
What do we want from our houses? Well, I'll tell you what people tell me. Light, space, and that inside-outside thing, that connection with nature. Teo and Elaine wanted that, and they didn't get it from some glossy magazine. They got it by importing all the ideas that they knew from experience would make them happy, would work. This place fascinates me, not just because it works so well for them, but also because it is so well conceived. It might work for anybody.